Hey, what's up, everybody? This is going to be the follow-up to the Q&A video that I posted. This is basically just going to be, me going through the ones that you asked. I was really, really—I don't want to say surprised, but I was just really happy with the amount of questions I got and the quality. You guys asked some really, really good questions, so I just want to kind of dive right into them. I haven't ordered these in any particular way. It's mainly just in the order that they came up on the video. So they might seem a little bit, in a weird order, but this is just the order that they popped up in. So this first one's from Ogre Steel, and he actually asks a few questions. And the first one is about a Sigma weapon chart that he posted. And I actually saw this, I think, a while ago, but I didn't really take a second look at it. It's a little confusing, but I think it's some kind of breakdown on damage dealt to Doku. I'll post the link just on the description of this video if you guys want to see it. But the reason that it's not all that relevant, Ogre, you do ask if it's accurate. I would assume it is, looking at the damage dealt. But every boss actually has different amounts of health. For example, if you do, a forward Y with a heavy weapon on a worm versus Doku or Marbus, it's going to do way more damage to the worm because the worms have less health. So, the weapons don't have like a set damage value in the same way that they would in something like a an RPG or something, something like a Fable game or something like that. They don't have like a set damage. It's dependent on the enemy you're using it on more often than not. But yeah, the chart itself is kind of hard to read, if you guys want to take a look at it, but it's not too bad. But in terms of accuracy, I'm sure it is. I haven't checked, I haven't tested like every wall attack on Doku, but I'm sure it is accurate. But in terms of relevancy, like it doesn't really mean anything. It's just numbers, and numbers, without context, don't really mean all that much. So his next question is, even with all your experiences with the game, is there still a part which you'd call unfair or BS? For me personally, the Master Ninja Great Bridge challenge is ridiculous without Inferno spam. I hate laser crab fiends in general, including mission mode. There's plenty of things in this game that are cheap as hell, even with all the experience. The short answer to this question is that you can be just as cheap, so that. I mean, you can be way cheaper than anything in this game, so that is kind of where the balance comes from. But I mean, there's plenty of things that are annoying. Chief among them, I think, are the dual boss missions in mission mode. I really don't think they were thought out all that well. There is no kind of, fair way to fight those missions. You have to be super cheap to beat those missions consistently. And even if you try the really cheap methods, sometimes, especially the Nikkei and Ishtaros one, sometimes they just won't behave in the way they need to complete that mission. If Nikkei doesn't swoop at you to get your wall attacks to hit, which is the safest way to do that mission, you're not doing that mission. You're just not one stray hit from any of those bosses, and you're pretty much dead, which is gonna happen. So yeah, I think they are kind of silly. They don't really feel all that, well thought out. Cat fiends are their own brand of BS as well. The fact that some of their attacks can triple connect on you for just no reason at all is really strange. Sometimes the guard crushing is a little inconsistent. Like the laser, the crab fiends, their slide attack, sometimes it guard crushes you, sometimes it doesn't. It's like, that's kind of weird. There's no real consistency to it. Fiend Mirai, I think, is the closest thing to unfair, like to truly unfair, the game actually has. They nerfed your kind of main tool against him, which was the Flying Swallow from NGO4. But his attacks just do so much damage, and they are so hard to dodge consistently. His chip damage is insane. Like, his shurikens are really, really good. Like, the range on his grab is just ridiculous. So I'd say he's probably the cheapest boss in the game. What else is there? I'd say that's about it off the top of my head. Oh, and the clones. I knew there was something I was forgetting. The clones are total horseshit. The thing about the clones, though, is that while they are completely stupid, you can be so cheap to the clones, it doesn't really matter. As soon as you figure out, like, just how easy it is to cheese the clones, they stop being an issue pretty quickly. But until you know all that stuff, like, they're pretty cheap. I mean, I think they just need to tone down their damage and they would have been fine. But yeah, just like the amount of damage the clones do to you is just, it's so over the top and it's so unnecessarily high. So that's about it off the top of my head. His next question is, you talked about a fellow Iberians member planning a Supreme Master Ninja mode, which nowadays people would call Ultimate Ninja. Yeah, you're right, they probably would. Other than Launchable Ninja or Samurai, do you remember anything more? And what would you rather see? New stuff or rearranged stuff? Every single enemy is a berserker, for example. Every single enemy being berserkers would be super boring, but depending on what weapons they gave you, that'd actually be kind of easy. But yeah, the member in question, his name's Edge AOM. He was one of the really early kind of pioneers, you could say, of the game. If I remember rightly, I think he was the first one who thought of not leveling up your heavy weapons in a karma run. I could be wrong about that, but I think he was the first one that showed that. I think he kept the Dabiru at level 2, and then it was Kyori who, thought of keeping them at level 1. But I think it was Edge who first did that, and he might have been the first to hit 22 million. So he was a real early on in the game. Like, he was a powerhouse in terms of like ability. He was incredibly good. But yeah, I do remember a few other things about it. He had you, I think the nunchucks and the flails he combined into one weapon. Like, nunchucks were level 1, level 2 you'd get level 1 flails, level 3 you'd get level 2 flails. If I remember rightly, he significantly restricted items. He might have taken talismans out altogether. I can't remember. I can't remember if he did. This is going back years, and unfortunately, he made a thread about it and he'd update it. Unfortunately, that thread's now gone. But I think he restricted items. I think all the technique scrolls were super expensive, like they were in the Hurricane packs. I think they were like 20 grand. I think Nimpo, again, was super expensive. Like, all your items were just insanely expensive. I'm trying to think of other enemies. Oh, I know one thing he put in. I think once you got the Kitetsu, that was a new weapon. You could dual wield the Kitetsu and Dragon Sword. I can't remember it, like, much past that in terms of, like, abilities that I gave you. But that was one thing he did. I think he did do something else with Fiend Challenges, but I can't remember, to be honest. That's all I can remember for certain. As I said, it was so long ago. Like, that's probably going back like way over 10 years now, when he made that stuff. So that's as much as I can remember, reliably. His last question is: it's pretty much a fact that NGB is the best. I would agree with that. But what did they need to change or go back to make NG4 great? Less quick time events, better story, better weapons, difficulty, etc., etc. This is a really good question, and it's something that even when Ninja Gaiden 2 came out, and it was pretty obvious early on that Ninja Gaiden 2, wasn't as good as the original, because games have changed a lot since then. Ninja Gaiden Black and even Ninja Gaiden 2's replayability, it comes from the lure or the appeal of mastering a set of mechanics, Ninja Gaiden Black more so, but I mean, even in Ninja Gaiden 2, once you get really, really good at Ninja Gaiden 2, it's pretty hard to get screwed over in that game. If you're really careful and you play by the rules, you can manipulate stuff in that game to a point where you are extremely powerful. And that is even more true in NGB. If you play really safe and you play really conservatively, you're almost invincible in NGB once you know everything. Granted, there is a lot to know, but that is the appeal of the game. It's learning all that stuff is the appeal. Nowadays, that's kind of not the case, really. It's definitely not the case for me personally. There's a few games, like Neo is a good example. Like, I really like Neo as a game. I thought it was great, but I simply don't have the time to learn that game, like a lot of people have that have gotten really good at it. I just liked it on the base mechanical level. So when it comes to like doing NG4 and kind of making it good or great or like the same as NGB, I think it's really interesting to think, what does it need? It definitely needs the controls, the responsiveness of the controls for NGB was a big part. The performance of NGB, the solid frame rate and just the way that ties into everything and makes everything nice and crisp and it runs really smooth. It definitely needs all the technical stuff, but in terms of like the nitty-gritty stuff, like how would you structure it? Like, is a mission mode enough in this day and age? Is 46 missions enough to keep people playing a game long term now? Is leaderboards enough? Is the lack of a multiplayer enough? do they, you know, would they have DLC as missions or costumes, or, you know, how would they do a scoring system that would keep people playing? You know, would they have events, for example? I'm trying to think of a game that did something like that. Just off the top of my head, Halo Reach, for example, that used to have all these like daily challenges and weekly challenges and monthly challenges. You know, could Ninja Gaiden benefit from something like that? Maybe like they could have a mission challenge, for example. Like this week, there's a running contest to see who can do this mission the best, or can you beat it without taking damage? Like, I think that's the most interesting part about a Ninja Gaiden 4 to me is, how do you make like a third person action game that is primarily single player focused work and like make it a heavy hitter in this day and age? Because from my experience, they're struggling. You know, I'm trying to think of recent ones. Like the DMC remake was a good example. I thought that game was fantastic, and I'm a pretty diehard Devil May Cry fan. And that game didn't do all that well, even though I really think it should have. That was a really good game. Granted, it wasn't, I wouldn't put it on the same level as the old DMCs, but you know, it did something different, and it was very successful at that. But people either just didn't really take to it, or people just didn't want to move past DMC. I feel a Ninja Gaiden game would be similar. Ninja Gaiden 3 notwithstanding, because I think that game was just legitimately bad in core ways, but you know, how do you make that game work in this day and age? Funnily enough, I recently got a Wii U because I wanted to play Bayonetta 2 finally, and I bounced off Bayonetta 2 after like 4 missions. It just didn't grab me at all, even though mechanically it was great. It just didn't keep me coming back, you know. And I couldn't really put my finger on why. It was like, I just don't really want to play it, you know. It is more Bayonetta, and I played a lot of the original Bayonetta, and I guess I realized I didn't want more of that, really. So, you know, maybe Ninja Gaiden 4 needs to be different, you know. Maybe it needs to go more the DMC reboot route than just trying to be Ninja Gaiden Black 2, which I'm open to, but, you know, who knows, a lot of people might not be. You know, with the DMC reboot is anything to go by, people don't want that, you know. They don't want what they know changed. Even if what they offer is really good. So that's a really interesting question. I wish I knew the answer. If I knew the answer, I'd make the game. I really don't know. I do think one thing they definitely need to do, Team Ninja in particular, they need to make some goodwill up with the Ninja Gaiden name. I really think they do. Razor's Edge is definitely a step in that direction, but Ninja Gaiden 3 hurt that series a lot. You know, in terms of just, you know, financially and just the word of mouth, that game was just a total bomb. So they need to kind of make up some goodwill. For me, I think the easiest way to do that is just NGB HD with the Hurricane packs in it, because that game still holds up. And, you know, the way that I still find out by people watching these videos is that people are still getting into that game now. So give them a way to play it on the new hardware. Give them a way to play it on the Xbox One, the PS4, the PC, because then you get people playing it again. You get people discovering that, and, you know, putting that game out for, like, I don't know, what would that game be now? Like, probably like one of like the £15-20 range, like, you know, the Live Arcade kind of prices, like $15-20. That's a lot of game for $15, or, you know, like £12-15. It's a lot of game. It's a lot of content for that amount of money, and I think that would do a good job in, you know, building up some goodwill, which is, I think, the main thing that Team Ninja needs to really kind of seriously think about doing a Ninja Gaiden 4. So, yeah, I don't know. I don't know what they need to change or go back to. As I said, it's a really interesting question. I'd like to hear what more you guys think, if you want to post in the comments about it. So, thanks for Ogre Steel. That was his questions. Thanks again for posting those. Really, really good questions. So, moving on, we've got Fun Counting. He asks, when's Ninja Gaiden 4? Good question. I don't know. In all seriousness, though, like, I do wonder whether we'll see a Ninja Gaiden 4 ever. Like, I don't really know. We might do, we might not. But I'm just going to take a sip of water here, guys, so I'll be 1 second. Okay, I'm back. Okay, so the next question comes from the Man of Rash. He asks again. He asks a couple of questions, three actually. He asks, could you make a video explaining the differences between NG04, NGB, and Sigma? NG04, for anyone that doesn't know, is Ninja Gaiden, the original remake Ninja Gaiden, the one that came out in 2004. I know a lot of people who have only played the Sigma version, for instance, and although I can explain it a bit why NGB is the definitive version, the backwards draw lamination being different from Sigma, etc., I'm not clued up enough to feel confident in the information I'm giving them. If you could do an objective video breakdown between the games, it would be awesome. That would be pretty easy to do, actually, but my kind of to-do list for Ninja Gaiden videos is pretty long at the moment. I've really been enjoying doing these tutorial breakdowns because I think they really dissect the game in a way that hasn't been done before. And to me, that's the most fun part. It's always been the most fun part about games is breaking down the mechanics. That's what I really love to do. And it's why I generally don't play like a huge amount of games, because that's what I like to do with every game, you know. Like, Devil May Cry is a good example, you know. Like, I know that game's mechanics pretty well, you know, pretty in-depth. Bayonetta, it would be another one. Ninja Gaiden 2. The Halo games, the Gears of War games, you know. I kind of stick with one and really get, you know, into the nitty-gritty. But that could definitely be something to do. NG04 and NGB, like, between the three of them, they don't have, like, drastic differences. It's just that because the application of all the mechanics in those games is so important that even altering a slight thing about it, you know, even altering the slightest detail is going to give you a big change. You know, it's kind of like tuning an engine, you know. Even if you make just one slight adjustment somewhere, it can actually be a massive difference to the overall, you know, performance. So, but yeah, that's definitely something to think about. His next question is kind of related, but a video explaining why NG2 plays so differently and is such a different game to the originals. That would also be really good, but that would be pretty difficult without people already knowing why. The main way that NG2 plays so differently, and it is hard to see it, but Ninja Gaiden and Ninja Gaiden Black and Sigma are defensive-orientated games. As I said, you know, once you know all the enemies and know all their attacks, all you have to do is block and evade, and you can just get through everything fine. Ninja Gaiden 2 is way more in the opposite end of the spectrum. It's full-on offensive. I can't remember who coined this phrase, but it's the perfect way to describe Ninja Gaiden 2. And they said that all you have to do is die slower than your enemies, and you'll be fine. Because in Ninja Gaiden 2, you cannot avoid taking damage, you know, consistently. I know there's probably no hurt runs out there, but as I said, with a lot of stuff, you know, you don't see the 100 tries where they got hit, you know. Like, no hurt runs in that game are kind of misleading, I think. Because there's going to be a billion resets where they actually took damage, they just decided to restart. So yeah, with Ninja Gaiden 2, you have to be content in taking damage. And that was the biggest adjustment for the Ninja Gaiden scene when that game came out, because we were all used to playing so defensively that when NG2 came out, we didn't want to be aggressive, because if you try and play Ninja Gaiden Black aggressively, you will die. Like, you cannot play overly aggressive. You can play somewhat aggressive, depending on the enemy and the situation, but if you just play like a madman, you are going to get killed. There's just no two ways about it. In NG2, you can play like a madman. It encourages that kind of play. That's why I enjoyed playing survival more than the main game, and it's why I enjoyed breaking down survival mode when I did. It's because survival mode was kind of viewed as just, like, really hard, really cheap, like, there was no kind of pattern to it or anything, and I thought, nah, you know, I think there is actually a pattern here, but we need to dig into it, and that's why I like doing that. But yeah, that is the main reason. It's because NG2 is about offensiveness, and NGB is defense. That's, like, the main difference. In a video explaining the two, even though they feel similar, as you said, like, they are completely different games, you know. Just because you're good at NG2... doesn't mean you'll be good at NGB, and vice versa, you know. Good NG2, and to be honest, that is kind of, history's kind of proven that, you know. There's very, very few players that were really good in both games. Very few. Either you had people that went from NGB to NG2 and didn't like it and just stopped playing, or you had people that were, like, either not good at NGB or, like, not great, or people that came into NG2 and, like, kind of found their groove with NG2. I'm trying to think, like, early on, it took me a while to warm up to NG2, but I stuck with it for quite a while. I'm trying to think of anyone else. off the top of my head, like it's man. I mean, part of it's my memory. I'm trying to think back to the Iberian, the other days. Rame did a Rhyme 0027 on the forums. Like he stuck with it. His Master Ninja walkthrough was actually very, very important for that game. I think that helped a lot of people. Big Al stuck with it as well. Man, who else? Like, as I said, a lot of people wrote it off. Like, a lot of people wrote off NG2. It was very, very different. Your spitball. Oh, sorry. And his third question is your spitball ideas on your ideal NGO4. This kind of ties into what Ogre asked. My ideal NG4. I said NGO4, didn't I? Ninja Gaiden 4, he means. I have no idea, man. As I said, like I think that's really interesting. I think gaming has changed so much since even Ninja Gaiden 2. Ninja Gaiden 2 was almost 10 years ago now. Ninja Gaiden, NGO4 was 13 years ago. Gaming has changed so much since then. And in a lot of ways, so have I. Like I don't really play new games all that much. It's very, very rare I play new stuff. So like my ideal NG4 would be like, something similar in structure, I guess, to Ninja Gaiden Black. That's the one thing I really missed from Ninja Gaiden Black. I love that Ninja Gaiden Black was an adventure game in a lot of ways, Ninja Gaiden 2 had some great levels and it had some great environments, but the way the whole map fits together in NGB, I think, is really cool and it's really clever. And it's something you don't get in many action games. I replayed DMC 1 and 3 this year, actually. And that was something that really stuck out in those games that I didn't really notice beforehand. In Devil May Cry 1, I mean, that has Resident Evil roots in it that you can really notice now with hindsight. But the way that whole game fits together is really cool. You go into the castle, and then you go into the basement of the castle, and then you go outside the castle, and then you go over the drawbridge. The whole thing fits together. The same way NGB does. You come out of the Hayabusa village, and then you get to Tyron, but then you go further than Tyron. You go into the depths of Tyron, and then you get into the Fiend Realm, but then you come back into the Hayabusa village, which leads you back everywhere. NG2 is, you go from point A to point B to point B to point C to point D. None of it fits together. And while the levels are cool and they look great, it just feels a little disjointed, you don't really feel like you're in an environment. You just feel like you're in a kind of an obstacle course, to get to the next level. And I think DMC3 has that same problem. And I think I wrote about this on my blog a while ago, but I think in that aspect, like DMC3 has aged really badly in that aspect because the environments and the game as a whole in DMC3, it's so boring. It's so boring to look at and go through. You think, as I said, at least NG2 looks really impressive. Like the later levels in NG2 look fantastic. DMC3 looks boring as hell. It's a gray mess of just grayness and nothing. Like there's nothing to it. So that's one thing I would like. That's one kind of design core that I would love to see come back in a Ninja Gaiden sequel is. Give us that adventure game feel of the first game, where everything is linked and everything fits together like an old school adventure game. I really, really like that. So moving on now. Thanks, Rash, for your questions. Really, really like them. Really appreciate you guys posting these. This is something I've been meaning to do for ages, and this is getting pretty long. I might actually split this up into two parts because, as you may know, I have a tendency to ramble. So Bright Superstition asks, he asks a few questions. Number one, please do a tutorial on how to, please do a video tutorial rather, on how to consistently dodge Awakened Alma's multi-fireball spam. I always get clipped by one or two of them no matter what direction I roll. This is a really interesting one. There's only a couple of people that I can think of off the top of my head, actually no, three. It's Trent Steele, Kyori, and Passaren. They are the only three people who I've seen dodge that move almost 100% consistently, and there's two reasons why. The first is that it is extremely hard to do. I mentioned it in a stream, I think. The arc you have to take, I will try and make the video eventually, and it will be in the Awakened Alma video, but I'll try and describe it here briefly. The arc you have to take is a perfect curve around the trajectory of those fireballs, because the thing about those fireballs is they track you horizontally, not vertically. Regular Alma and Nikkei's fireballs track you vertically, so as long as you move, erratically to the left or right, you will dodge them because they are tracking your vertical position. whereas Awakened Nalma's fireballs track you horizontally. So they are tracking you as you're rolling and jumping, which is why you need to go in the forward curve arc, not a, you know, a horizontal line arc. And that's why they're so hard to dodge. The other reason is because I think on Master Ninja there's like 12 or 16 of them. There's a lot to dodge. And sometimes, and this is the unfortunate thing, depending on the angle or the position where you are when she initiates that attack, it isn't actually possible to dodge all of them. You may be able to like take a little bit of guard damage and not get hit by the rest, but at least one or two of them will clip you depending on where you are in the arena. And that's just one of those things. If you really don't want to take damage, then just Nimpo. But that is the thing that is really annoying. But yeah, I will cover that in the Awakened Alma video, but just know that, you know, sometimes it's not you. Sometimes you just can't dodge them. It's just not possible, which sucks, but it's one of those things. The next question is, I watched some videos of Japanese players on the original NGO 4 attacking one enemy and then immediately throwing a shuriken at another enemy. How do you do this? Can you even do this in NGB? I did post on this just so I could clarify what you meant, and you did respond, so I can go into this in more detail now. Yes, the way they're doing that is, again, this is something the game doesn't teach you, and this will be in a projectile tutorial video, but you can actually aim your projectiles with the analog stick, and the game doesn't tell you that you can do that. So, for example, if you have two fiends, so you've got one in front of you and one to the right of you, with incendiary shurikens equipped, you could do something like XXY or XYX to launch them, and then before you press B, hold the left stick to the right, and Ryu, sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes, and most of the time, to be fair, he will actually throw the shuriken or the projectile in the direction that you are pushing the analog stick. If you want a good example of this, go and look at the segmented speedrun I did for normal, and go and look at the red eye room. I think someone may have asked that in the comments on that video, actually. But yeah, go and look at the red eye room. And that's how I get through that room so quickly, is because I'm actually aiming all of those individual incendiary shurikens. If I just let Ryo's auto-aim take over, like, you'd never get that room that smooth. So yeah, if you want a good example, go and check that out. But that is how you do that. And yeah, you can do it in NGB. Again, it's just something that they don't tell you, which is annoying. His next question, how the hell does the end of chapter rankings work? I sometimes think I'm about to get Master Ninja, but only get Head Ninja, and sometimes I think I'm about to get Head Ninja and then get Master Ninja. The only thing I can tell you for certain on the master, on the rankings, is that kills are the most important thing. If you get a low amount of kills compared to the... because each chapter has a set amount of kills, which is the maximum, which means you killed every enemy in the chapter. Those in and of themselves aren't 100% accurate, but that is the main thing that is like tracking when it comes to your ranking. Time and Nimpo and Essence do factor into it, but kills is by far the main thing. For example, you can fail Time, Nimpo, and Essence. You can fail the other three, but just get max kills, and on some chapters you'll still get Master Ninja. So, yeah, those rankings don't really mean all that much, which is kind of weird. Next question, after finally beating Master Ninja difficulty in NGB recently, I decided to try out the mission mode bits. Holy shit, some of the stuff there is just borderline bullshit. I could cheese through so many encounters in the main campaign with smoke bombs, but I can't do the same in mission mode since a lot of them don't even give me smoke bombs. How do I beat them without luck? That's going to depend on what missions you're talking about. I could probably hazard a guess, but general rule of thumb is you need to understand what it is smoke bombs are doing. And this is kind of what I mean by how smoke bombs are so good. Smoke bombs are removing the need to either get round an opponent's armor or their defense. And by that, you know, armor is when they block your attack or defense is when they dodge. And the reason it's doing that is because in order to get around that, usually, you have to either evade that enemy or cause that enemy to whiff, or you need to windrun them, or you need to stun them with another string. Removing all that and just using, and basically just making smoke bombs kind of the magic button, because all you got to do is press B, and then that does all that for you. That's probably why you're having trouble. You've probably become a little bit too reliant on the smoke bombs. And in order to get around that, you need to be able to manipulate those enemies. And that's the key of the combat in Ninja Gaiden Black. If you can manipulate the enemies and cause them to whiff when you want them to, and get them to maneuver where you want them to, then that's how you control an encounter. So, you said that beat them without luck, so let's look at some of the missions. Military Destruction 4 is a good example of this. That's a very tough mission, for two reasons. Because you have to keep track of the helicopter, but you also have to manipulate the two soldiers it gives you. So, for example, when you have the armored guys, they block your flying swallow, and they have a very high tendency to counter you or block your attacks. So usually if you have smoke bombs, I mean, you don't have them, you don't have soldiers in that mission anyway on story mode, but for example, you could just press B, stun them, Izuna drop them, piece of cake, and then you, all you've got to do is worry about the helicopter. If you don't have smoke bombs in that mission, which I can't remember if you do, but you actually have to work your way around those enemies. So that means you have to either wind run them or stun them while keeping that helicopter in your view and keeping track of its attacks and keeping track of how to dodge its attacks while keeping track of the soldiers. And that's what makes the combat difficult. It's keeping track of everything and manipulating everything at the same time. So that's probably what's happening there. You've probably just become a little bit too reliant on smoke bombs and not actually taking as much notice of the enemies that you could be. Feel free to post the missions you're having trouble with, and I can go into further detail in that, because this is definitely going to be more than one video. This is already half an hour long. Final question, am I cheating if I draw a dot in the middle of my screen to indicate where arrow shots will go? Because that tower sequence in Chapter 9 where I have to shoot those 9 targets drives me insane. No, you're not cheating. A lot of people used to do that back in the day. Once you play the game enough, you'll just know where that arrow's going to hit, trust me. You'll be able to just hold B, quickly aim, and boom. It'll look like you've got an aimbot on. But yeah, trust me, with enough practice, you will just know where that arrow's going to hit every single time. So what we got here? I'll do two more, and then we'll do a part two of this. The Wogil, I think, asks... I think that's it. I played both NGB and NG2 on the Xbox. After some or a lot of struggle, I managed to beat Master Ninja on both. Well played, because that's something not a lot of people have done. I also planned on conquering the challenges, and I want to ask some advice. Cool. How do you approach a certain challenge? Trial and error, or more strategy and planning? It's a combination of both, especially when you're new at the game. I'll give you an example. So when I first played Military Destruction 2, that was a mission that just bodied everybody when Ninja Gaiden Black was new, because we'd never had to fight those tanks with help. You know, it was completely new. It was like, oh crap, like how do we deal with this? So my first strategy was going to be, okay, I'm just going to incendiary shuriken these soldiers and then I'm going to kill the tanks. And it worked and I felt really good. I was like, oh yeah, I'm so smart. Then, of course, the armored soldiers turned up, and you can't incendiary shuriken those. So I thought, oh, shit. Well, that strategy doesn't really work. But the first half of that strategy works, you know. You can use incendiaries on the squidgy soldiers, which are the ones you can stick with incendiaries. Then you need to be able to create an opening for yourself to use arrows on the other soldiers, or either windpath them to Izuna drop them. So then that gets into the thing of, you have a strategy, you know, you have a plan. How are you going to accomplish that? What are you going to do to actually get that plan to work? And in that particular example, you need to make the tank shoot his shell, because that tank shoots its cannon on a, you know, set routine. And then you need to disable the turret and then kill the soldier guy. But you need to do it in a particular pattern. Otherwise, when you do your Izuna drop or you end your attack on the soldier, the cannon's going to hit you. So it really is a combination of both. You know, if you have a strategy or a plan, don't be afraid to stick to it. You know, sometimes a lot of your strategies, you might think, oh, this is a terrible idea. But then it just kind of works, and you notice something, and you think, oh, I can just do this, and then this strategy works all the time. But on the same side of that, don't become too stubborn. You know, if a strategy just isn't working at all, then, you know, try something new. But yeah, it's just a combination of both, you know. Learn from your mistakes. That's always the main thing for Ninja Gaiden. You know, if something goes wrong, try and think, okay, what did I do wrong? What could I have done better? The next one is going to be, are the longer and harder challenges constantly beatable, or is there an amount of trial and error that will never go away? It depends on what you mean. If you're talking about fiend challenges, then no, like all of those are beatable. If you mean just like the harder stuff in the game, there are a few things. Like, for example, in mission mode, The double clone fight is one. Even if you want to be cheap and spam wall attacks, all it takes is like one stray windmill shuriken while you're running on the wall, and then the flail clone will just juggle you to death. There's nothing you can do about that. The flail clone in particular, he can just counterattack you and then just do a string and you're dead. There's nothing you can do about that. Awakened Alma, like, she can just do fireballs for days and never let you knock her down. You can't do anything about that. Giants of the Underworld 5, Nicanish Taros, doing that mission like 100 times in a row is probably not possible. So yeah, like, there are a few things, but there's not many of them, and the ones that there are, you know, they're not that bad. It's not like 100% luck, you know. There is always, skill is always more important than luck. Like, without a doubt, there's always going to be more skill than luck involved, but like with anything at the highest level, there's always a little bit of luck, you know. There's always a little bit of randomness in there. So I hope that answers your question. Final question for this one, as we're almost at 40 minutes here. Colin Abowd asks, can you please do another chapter-by-chapter karma run? This is an easy one. The answer is hell no. If you mean like a full-on karma run, just no way. It's funny, I put up my stream for Military Destruction 5 in between doing this, and hopefully that shows you why I'm never, ever doing that again. I'll go into a bit more detail. That final karma run I did completely burnt me out on the game. I don't know if I've talked about this in another video, but I actually stopped playing NGB for like 2 years after finishing that karma run, because it burnt me out so much. It was literally just grinding the living hell out of the game. Just hours and hours and hours and hours a day. You know, I'm literally talking like, you know, 5 hours on one fight just to get like an extra 300 points. You know, and it just really turned me off the game. It really made me sour on the game in a lot of ways. The no reset karma runs really got me back into karma running in a way that I never thought I'd get back into. And in hindsight, I kind of think no reset runs are what should have been the norm. That run really highlighted, like, you know, in a karma run of this caliber, once the knowledge is there, once the knowledge and execution are there, it really is just a matter of time. It's how much time are you willing to, you know, put into this to get the pattern you want. There's actually a lot less execution involved once you have it, because, and that's why I like the no reset stuff, because on the fly karma running is way harder and it requires, you know, really quick thinking, because you don't have infinite time. So yeah, like a full-on chapter-by-chapter karma run, just not going to happen. Karma run tutorials is something that I've kind of toyed with the idea of in the past. I think that would be really cool to do. But yeah, like full-on 100% karma run, never happening. No way. Like, I'd have to get, like, godlike powers in exchange for doing that. And even then, I'm not sure that'd be enough. So yeah, unfortunately, no, if that's going to happen, it's not going to come from me. So, sorry about that, if you were hoping that there was going to be a glimmer of hope there. There isn't, unfortunately. Anyway, that's going to do it for part one, guys. Again, thanks again for all the great questions. I'll try and get these out once a day over the next few days, so it doesn't take long. But thanks again for all the questions. Really, really great questions. And I will see you guys in part two. Take care.